This is BBC One for the South East. Now, the story of how Dartford powered the British beat boom.
It's the early 60s, and a legion of British bands are ready for action. The Americans have been shooting rock and roll at us over the Atlantic for years, and the mop-top troops of the UK are about to return fire.
He said they're called the Beatles.
But as the British invasion is about to be launched, where will the troops get their weapons?
Most things that are worth doing are dangerous.
Who will give them the tools to do the job?
The distortion factor on it is very, very low indeed.
We're about to hear the story of one small company which took on the world with a handful of valves in an old shed in Dartford. They broke the rules.
I told him no.
And defined the sound of the 60s.
It sounded like a rhino being killed.
It's a story that begins with bombs and ends in tears.
He was crying, and I've never seen a man cry before. He was so upset.
This is the story of Vox.
I'm Ian Lee, and I can tell you that that isn't any old guitar amplifier.
It is, in fact, a classic Vox AC30, built by Jennings Musical Industries of Dartford in 1964. Many guitarists say that the AC30 was the best amp ever made.
The AC30 really is kind of a gift from God.
But the sound was so sweet, it really sung, you know. Just a wonderful sound.
And that, with that Vox, the AC30, is the first time it all came together.
Pop music is my life's passion, but the story of how Dartford powered the British beat boom in the 60s has long been forgotten, even by the people of Dartford. This is how it happened.
It was rock and roll which brought us the electric guitar. Before that, things were very different.
In the 1950s, there was only one thing better than an accordion. And that's two accordions. This TV show was extremely popular, and the squeeze box was all the rage all over the world. Tom Jennings was an accordionist. During the war, he used to work at an armaments factory. There, he met a guitar player called Dick Denny. They would play together in the air raid shelters as the bombs dropped around them.
And everybody used to have a sing-song, and so everybody was sort of calm during the air raids.
After the war, Tom opened up a music shop in Dartford, where they specialised in refurbishing old accordions. But he wanted to get into manufacturing, not accordions, but something a bit more space-age.
What on earth is this?
This is the Univox. It was the first electronic product that Jennings produced.
Oh. Steady on.
It was basically a kind of valve synthesizer.
I think it's dying.
It may be on its last legs.
We've killed it.
Rest in peace.
Many pop music geeks are convinced that the Univox was the instrument used on the number one single by the Tornadoes, Telstar. Others say it definitely wasn't.
But that doesn't matter. The important thing is that Tom Jennings had started to make musical equipment, and his next move would define the sound of the 60s.
Rock and roll arrived from America. Suddenly, everyone wanted electric guitars, and when they got them, they'd need amplifiers as well. Tom saw his chance and cannibalised the Univox.
The Univox had inside it an amplifier, and from this, the first Vox amp, called the G10, was developed, and it was basically a reworking of the Univox amp.
But it wasn't great. So Tom roped in his old wartime chum, Dick Denny, because Dick knew about electronics and he was also a guitarist. What he came up with used AC electricity and it put out 15 watts of power. So it was called the AC-15. And the sound that it made was seized upon by the biggest band in Britain, The Shadows.
I don't know who contacted who, but we finished up with Vox AC-15s.
People who used to work for Jennings Musical Industries in Dartford will vouch for the fact that the AC-15 was a major step forward. The company was doing okay with Dick Denny's Electronic Creations and Tom Jennings at the helm.
He was a very motivated individual, extremely hardworking, good sense of humour.
He was really nice man. Tom was a nice man, very approachable. You know, when he come in, he was the boss.
He was also quite volatile. He could go up like a volcano. If things weren't quite going how they should be, he could be, he'd come down just as quick.
Dick Denny, what was he like?
Very nice man. Very, very nice man.
He used to wear these cardies and he used to have pockets there. And he used to put his hand in his pockets and he used to do these puppets with his liners of his pockets and make out, you know, tell us stories with these puppets.
An entertainer, always an entertainer.
But the Shadows came to Dick with a request about his AC-15.
Is there any chance of sort of making this amplifier bigger or louder? Because, you know, the kids were screaming at Cliff, you know, you couldn't hear anything.
So Dick wanted to make a kind of double amp with two speakers in it. He went to see Tom.
No, 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 says Tom. No, no. Too heavy, too loud, you know, too big, all rest of it. Go away, forget about it.
But Dick wasn't taking no for an answer. He began knocking up some twin versions of the AC-15 on the quiet, just to help out bands like The Shadows who wanted more volume. But he got caught out when Tom spotted the paperwork for the parts.
Tom looked at it and went, I told him no. Unfortunately, Dick was walking past the office. Door opens, Tom comes out. Dick, in my office, now.
Tom and Dick had a huge row.
Eventually, the door opens. Out comes Dick, you know, sort of white-faced. We expected him to have his P-45s in his hand. And we all said, what happened, Dick? And he said, he says we can make 10, and on my own head be it. And that was the birth of the AC-30.
Dick had come up with this, recognised by many guitarists to this day as the classic of all guitar amplifiers.
They're just great amplifiers. We could suddenly hear the amps above all the screaming.
The sound was good. That was your main criteria. The sound had to be good, and the sound was good. It was a vast improvement on any British amp that had come before.
Things just seemed to come right in it. It met all the molecules of the whole amplifier, and the guitar seemed to join up into the right, into line up into this most beautiful kind of order.
So what's the difference between the Vox sound and its main competitors, the Fender and the Marshall?
The Fender sound is all clean, lots of bass, lots of treble, and it's the sound of America in the 60s.
Let's go over to the Marshall. What does that sound like?
Bigger box, more power, more distortion. This is rock.
The Vox, what's so distinctive about that sound?
Okay, it's a very different kind of circuit. Clean. Clean, glassy. For me, at least, the Vox is all about Hank.
Things were going quite well. But Vox had no idea what was about to hit them. It began when the manager of an unknown band walked into their retail shop in London. His band was a bit hard up, and he said he wanted some amplification.
I said, well, we can sell you that. So he said, no, I don't want to buy it. I want you to give it to them. I said, oh. So who is this band? He said, they're called the Beatles. They've been playing in the Star Club in Hamburg. I said, I see. I said, well, we don't give stuff away. So he said, yeah, but the advertising that you'll get from this will be enormous.
So Reg got on the phone to the governor, Tom Jennings, who didn't take kindly to the idea.
Do what? He said, screaming over the phone. What do you think we are? Some philanthropic society? He used a stronger word, but I censored that. He said, who is this crowd? So I said, they're called the Beatles. He said, that's not a very good name for a start.
Nevertheless, Reg did a part exchange deal with the cash-strapped manager, Brian Epstein, who made him a promise.
Whilst I'm manager of the Beatles, he said, they will never use anything else other than Vox. And they never did.
Within a year, Vox found themselves being promoted by the biggest band of all time.
How much did that cost?
Absolutely nothing.
Back in Dartford, sometime in the mid-60s, a potential customer was worried that the Vox valves would be too fragile to go on the road. Were they reliable?
So we rolled it down three flights of stone steps. Took it back up on the lift, plugged it in, and Dick could play it through perfectly. So is that reliable enough for you?
Simultaneously, there was another product of Kent that was about to hit the big time.
No, you weren't, Mick. You were born in Dartford. In fact, Mick Jagger was born here at the Livingston Hospital in 1943, and so was Keith Richards. 19 years later, Mick and Keith met on the Dartford train.
They got together with a bunch of other teenage musicians, and they formed the Rolling Stones. The Stones then began a very close relationship with Vox. One of their early managers, Eric Easton, used to work at the company. Their early gigs were a showcase of Vox equipment. So Vox products were fully endorsed by the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, the Shadows, and practically every big name you could mention. They were a hit, and the orders flooded in.
Lord knows this town was already glamorous enough, but that's how Dartford became the powerhouse of British rock and roll.
We went down to Dartford, I think, a couple of times, obviously to meet Dick, see where they did it all.
The switchboard put straight through to this guy, he said, hi, Dick here. He was almost more enthusiastic than we were.
We could go to Dartford and they'd literally say, yeah, whatever you want.
All through the 60s, it was like Christmas every day. It just felt like Christmas.
We had all the pop groups, the Hollies, the Searchers, you name it, like the Animals. I mean, and some of them are so rude.
We know that Vox sounds different, but what makes it sound different? Some say it's the Celestion Blue G12 speakers that some of the models had. Some say it's the EL84 valves. But many put it down to a thing called no negative feedback. This is how it works.
If you have a hi-fi reproducing equipment, the idea is you want the speaker just to produce what you put in.
In other words, in a hi-fi, you must have as little distortion as possible.
You must have one of these better class units, which has ultra-linear output stages. The distortion factor on it is very, very low indeed.
Now, any amplifier is going to have some distortion, but there is a method of getting over that called negative feedback.
Hi-fi systems have a lot of negative feedback, so they only produce what you give them.
But what Dick Denny realised was that if you take the negative feedback out of a guitar amplifier and allow the amp and speaker to interact and distort, it actually makes an electric guitar sound better.
What it does is, in fact, it emphasises the harmonics. So the combination of the guitar and the emphasis of the extra harmonics gives you this fantastic AC30 sound.
What the Vox guys very cleverly did was just take off all the negative feedback. So you get a curve which goes up and is straight and then gradually goes into distortion. And it's that gradual curve which is the sound which I was looking for.
So Brian takes the Hank Marvin clear sound and pushes it into distortion.
At low volume, it's very nice and clean like we were talking about.
Yeah.
You can hear every note very clear as crystal. If you edge it up a little bit, it'll start to go into that kind of creamy saturation, which I'll show you. So that's halfway.
But yeah, if you go that's
the,
halfway.
That's sort of halfway up. That gives you the sort of... Okay. So then the whole... So you're starting like... A number of things happen, it gets